Poštovani predsjedniče Skupštine, bivši predsjednici država i vlada zemalja u regionu, uvaženi panelisti, ekscelencije, dragi uvaženi gosti i prijatelji, dame i gospodo, dozvolite mi da izrazim zahvalnost gospodinu Kneževiću za njegove lijepe riječi i ideje povezivanja uspješnog biznisa sa socijalnim pitanjima, solidarnošću i filantropijom, koje je iznio kao smjernice za ovu konferenciju koju je vlada Crne Gore organizovala u saradnji sa Atlas grupom. Dozvolite mi također da iskažem posebnu zahvalnost predsjedniku Clintonu što je danas ovdje sa nama i što je pružio potrebnu podršku našoj iskrenoj i ambicioznoj inicijativi Balkanska inicijativa za jačanje društva jugoistočne Europe. Također, želim da zahvalim učesnicima i gostima za vrijeme koje su odvojili za učešće na ovom skupu, koji će, uvjeren sam, biti značajna prekretnica u budućoj saradnji među političkim i biznis liderima u jugoistočnoj Europi. Jučer smo proslavili najznačajniji datum u našoj novijoj istoriji. Crna Gora je 21. maja 2006. godine, nakon gotovo jednog vijeka, obnovila državnost i odlučila da preuzme odgovornost za svoju budućnost u sopstvene ruke, istovremeno demonstrirajući demokratičnost procesa iznad uobičajenih standarda. Tokom protekle dvije, rekao bih, teške dekade, Crna Gora je sa uspjehom očuvala svoju dragocjenu vrijednost, multietničku, multikulturnu i multikonfesionalnu harmoniju i toleranciju. Predreferendumske demokratske procedure, koje su uz pomoć međunarodne zajednice pažljivo sprovedene, obezbijedile su miran i demokratski postreferendumski ishod u Crnoj Gori, atipičan za region Zapadnog Balkana. Svjedoci smo da su posljednjih godina dezintegracioni proces donijeli puno patnje među republikama bivše Jugoslavije, kao što je to predsjedniku Clintonu, kome je tokom mandata jedan od glavnih spoljnopolitičkih prioriteta bio balkanski konflikt, dobro poznat. Iz tog razloga, gospodin Clinton, njegovo prisustvo ovdje kao čovjeka koji je posvetio dobar dio vremena i napora u rješavanju konflikata u bivšoj Jugoslaviji, ne daje nam samo osjećaj zadovoljstva, već i više od toga, veliki podsticaj i odgovornost za nas da istrajemo u idealima oko kojih smo ovdje okupljeni. Za veliko poštovanje nastavak njegovih humanih dostignuća za stvaranje boljeg svijeta kroz rad fondacije koju predvodi. Ubrzo nakon sticanja nezavisnosti, Crna Gora je postala član brojnih multilateralnih organizacija, uz istovremeno uspostavljanje i snaženje bilateralne saradnje. Naši osnovni spoljnopolitički prioriteti su promovisanje dobrosusjedskih odnosa, integraciju evropske i euroatlantske strukture, unapređenje bilateralne saradnje. Mi u vladi snažno vjerujemo da jedino reformama iznutra i demokratizacijom i regionalnom saradnjom svi možemo postati prvo nama samima bolji, a onda je prihvaćeni od strane naših međunarodnih partnera u porodicu prosperitetnih demokratskih društava. Međutim, svi mi ovdje u jugoistočnoj Europi bi trebalo da snosimo odgovornost i ubiremo plodove ne tako jednostavnih koraka i napora koje svako od nas mora da preduzme. Najveći teret sprovođenja reformi je na nama, donosiocima odluka, nama koji smo u posjedu povjerenja građana koji su nas izabrali. Naše obaveze su refleksija izazova sa kojima se suočavamo. Ne postoji savršen obrazovni ili zdravstveni sistem, nema savršene pravde, kao što i ne postoji društvo u kome bi svaki građanin bio bez potrebe za pomoć. To ipak ne znači da mi ne bi trebali da težimo ka ostvarivanju naših ideja i ideala. Jedna od značajnijih sredstava na tom putu je saradnja i razmjena iskustava, kao i implementacija uporednih praksi među nama i na vladama naših zemalja je da obezbijedimo povoljne okolnosti kao preduslove za uspostavljanje efikasne saradnje. Danas svojom konzistentnom politikom Crna Gora je međunarodno prepoznata kao kredibilan i konstruktivan partner. Decembra prošle godine mi smo nagrađeni dobijanjem zvaničnog statusa zemlje kandidata za članstvo u Evropskoj uniji i veoma smo posvećeni ispunjavanju 7 ključnih kriterijuma kao uslova za otvaranje pregovora o članstvu. Članstvo u alijansi također je naša jasna perspektiva. Istovremeno, pouzdan smo partneri susjed svima, a odgovornim predsjedavanjem regionalnim inicijativama demonstriramo važnost regionalne saradnje koja čini preduslov za napredak u ispunjavanju evropske agende. Izazovi pred nama su veliki, ali je isto tako velika i naša odlučnost i entuzijazam. Kao i većina ostalih zemalja, Crna Gora se suočila sa negativnim posljedicama globalne ekonomske krize. Kriza je došla u vrijeme nakon postreferendumskog razvojnog praska, ali mi smo brzo konsolidovali naš financijski sistem i sada smo na putu ekonomskog rasta. Naša ekonomska politika je usmjerena na dalju stabilizaciju javnih financija, unapređenje poslovnog ambijenta i strukturne reforme sa ciljem uspostavljanja dugoročno stabilne, dinamične i konkurentne ekonomije i unapređenje kvaliteta života svih građana Crne Gore. Prepoznali smo značaj javno-privatnog partnerstva, razmatramo njegovu primjenu u oblastima zdravstva i obrazovanja u sklopu strukturnih reformi koje sprovodimo sa ciljem da sa manje javnih izvora finansiranja obezbijedimo kvalitetniji nivo javnih usluga. Uporedo sa ovim procesima radimo na kreiranju zakonskog okvira koji će na najbolji način urediti ovu oblast, oslanjajući se na znanja Evropskog ekspertskog centra za javno-privatno partnerstvo koji su osnovali Evropska investiciona banka i Evropska komisija. Vjerujem da će formalno potpisivanje ugovora koji će omogućiti dalju ekspertsku podršku, ali i pomoć u realizaciji konkretnih projekata, pružiti dodatan podstrek realizaciji značajnih projekata javno-privatnog partnerstva, posebno u ove dvije oblasti. U svim izvještajima od obnove nezavisnosti smo napredovali. Danas je Crna Gora prema izvještaju Freedom House-a svrstana među slobodne zemlje. Prema Human Development Indexu Ujedinjenih nacija i Indeksu globalne konkurentnosti Svjetskog ekonomskog foruma, među 50 smo zemalja. Prema izvještaju o lakoći poslovanja Svjetske banke zauzimamo 66. mjesto, ali smo po reformama bili lider u regionu 2010. godine. Naša je ambicija da radeći na unapređenju stanja u oblastima izvršavanja ugovora, dobijanja građevinskih dozvola, započinjanja biznisa, plaćanja poreza, registracije nepokretnosti, ne samo unaprijedimo poslovno okruženje za preduzetnike, već i smanjimo mogućnosti za korupciju, doprinoseći time i vladavini prava. Poštovane dame i gospodo, čvrsto sam uvjeren da je Crna Gora pravo mjesto za pokretanje ove inicijative. Raznovrsna iskustva učesnika i ljudi koji će nastaviti da vode ovu inicijativu je ključ njenog uspjeha. Pozivam vas sve lično da pružite podršku vašim iskustvom, znanjem i dobrom voljom. Nadam se da će ova konferencija postaviti čvrstu zajedničku osnovu za razumijevanje i razmjenu ideja i pogleda koji će doprinijeti svima nama i da će biti inicijalna kapisla koja će isprovocirati seriju budućih susreta koji će donijeti konkretne rezultate. Na samom kraju, zadovoljstvo mi je da vam poželim dobrodošlicu ovdje u Crnoj Gori. Nadam se da ćete se uvjeriti da su priče o Crnoj Gori kao mjestu prepoznatom po svojim prirodnim ljepotama i gostoprimstvu tačne, kao i da ćete naći vremena da mimo konferencije uživate u našem predivnom okruženju. Imamo velika očekivanja od obje panel diskusije, a siguran sam da smo svi nestrpljivi da čujemo i obraćanje predsjednika Clintona. Hvala na pažnji.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. First, let me thank the organizers of the conference and especially Duško Knežević. Thank you so much for giving me my chance to come to Montenegro for the first time. For years and years and years, I've been looking at pictures of this beautiful country in travel books. I was tired of looking at the pictures. I wanted to see the real thing. So I thank you. I'd like to thank Prime Minister Luksic. Thank you for your leadership and your report on the progress. Congratulations on the 5th anniversary of your independence, on your candidacy status for the European Union, on the work you are already doing with NATO. I'd like to thank the new American ambassador for being here. Thank you for joining me. And I'd like to especially acknowledge the presence of all the former leaders of the countries in this region who all served with me. All of us has-beens, we're here together, and we're glad to be here. Thank you. Thank you, my friend. In the 1990s, after the end of the Cold War and the breakup of the Soviet Union and the breakup of Yugoslavia, this part of the world was an open question. What would be the future? Would the ethnic and religious and cultural and political differences essentially lead the whole region to disintegrate into a cauldron of fighting. Same argument they're having in some places in the Middle East today. Oh, if you take this regime or that regime away, everything will go to pieces. And the future was entirely uncertain. And there was, of course, the war in Bosnia, and subsequently the brief clash in Kosovo. And many, many decisions had to be made, decisions which now looking back may seem to have been self-evident. They weren't. So first I would like to pay tribute to all these people who are here, because in very different ways, under very different circumstances, they all had to face the question of what would the 21st century be like. We knew then that the world was growing more interdependent. We knew there was more trade, there was more travel, there was also more terrorism and more trafficking. We knew that borders were being pierced. You could sell goods and services, and you could sell young girls away from their homes and their futures. The question was whether all this interdependence, with borders looking more like nets than walls, would look good or be chaotic. Would the positive forces of interdependence prevail here and throughout the world, or the negative ones? And the matter was in doubt, and in some sense remained in doubt. In fact, I think that the whole mission of civilized people in every corner of the earth today is to get back to a people-based society with the positive forces of interdependence overwhelming the negative one. I'm not naive enough to think that there will ever be a time on the planet when there won't be some people who are selfish, some people who are greedy, some people who abuse their power, when there won't be human tragedies or natural disasters that will derail progress. But make no mistake about it, the real challenge of the 21st century, played out in different ways in every corner of our planet, is whether the positive or the negative forces of our coming together will dominate. My vision when I became president was that we would try to create a series of global networks in which the United States would play a positive role in building up the positive and reducing the negative forces, the forces of integration as opposed to the forces of disintegration. In Europe, what I hoped to see was, for the first time since nation states arose on this continent, a genuinely united continent, united in peace, security, and democracy, with both functioning markets and strong governments to build social solidarity. We also established, or reestablished for the first time in 30 years, a regular network with our Latin American and Caribbean neighbors. We began for the first time ever to have regular meeting of the leaders of the Asia-Pacific region. We tried to create networks through free trade that was genuinely mutually beneficial. We had 300 different trade agreements when I was president, and created the World Trade Organization, and brought China in, and reestablished our friendship with India for the first time in a generation. All around the concept that this conference is using, networking. The whole idea of a network is that people should get together, work together, bring the best ideas, and that we're always doing better when we work together than when we go off on our own. So I would like to begin with that concept of networking. After I left office, we were laughing that at a meeting right before we came in here, my former colleagues and I, that life does not end when you leave office. You know, if you listen to all this fighting that's going on in the Middle East today, Mr. Gaddafi can't imagine what he would do if he didn't get to go up and tell everybody in Libya what to do every day. All these people have found something to do. This is a very important lesson. I started this foundation to try to help on the issues I cared about when I was president, where I could still have an impact as a former president. That's what the Club of Madrid does. That's what a lot of other such organizations do. I think we should make maximum use of this. I told President Djukanovic we should just take him to the Middle East and parade him around and prove to people that you can actually give up power and look like a big man doing it, even if you're not as tall as he is. This is a very important lesson, because all of you are here, and most of you were not in government, because you're interested in something that affects everybody. That means, as private citizens, you wish to do public good. You wish to advance the interests of Montenegro, the interests of all the ordinary people of the Balkans. And so I want to talk about that a little bit. The network is a good metaphor for the way the world should work. Many of our issues that we face today are quite complex, but we are certain to get the wrong answer if we ask the wrong question, or if we try to resolve the right question in the wrong way. Networks are inherently empowering. They support social solidarity. I just gave a speech at your Mediterranean University primarily about the prospects of future tourism and how the challenges of the world could affect it. But I pointed out that one of the countries I really admire today is Brazil, because of the way they try to create networks to resolve problems. And I have been just recently down there to a conference on how the Brazilians together can slow the destruction of the Brazilian rainforest, which produces 20% of all the oxygen all humanity breathes that is not produced from oceans, and has a lot of the biodiversity which may offer us future pharmaceutical breakthroughs to solve a lot of the illnesses of the world. But the most important thing is this: Brazil now has no easy answers. They're growing like crazy. They have oil offshore. They have 20 feet of topsoil in their farmland, the deepest in the world. Brazil and Argentina are the only place that have 20 feet left. They produce the world's most efficient biofuel, so that for 4 years in a row they've used more ethanol made from sugarcane than gasoline. But the more they use the good land for that, the more they push the cattle farmers and the soybean farmers into the rainforest. So they're becoming more sustainable and environmentally green with their fuel, but less environmentally green by forcing destruction of the rainforest. 90% of their electricity they produce from clean sources, really more than 95% from hydroelectric power. But they're growing, so they need more. They want it to be clean electricity and their own. The problem is all the rivers that are strong enough to support really powerful hydro plants are in the rainforest. And the best site of all, if they build a dam and generate electricity, would require them to destroy a native tribe that has literally lived alone in the rainforest for thousands of years. And under their constitution, such things are treasured and revered and to be protected. So what is the right answer? That's not the point. The relevance to the Balkans is this. I went to a meeting where the head of the Green Party, the environmentalist party, who ran third in the race for president, big showing, sat down with the heads of the utilities, the heads of the oil companies, the people who represent the indigenous Indians who want to preserve their way of life, sat down with the business people who are creating new jobs for Brazilians and new wealth and opportunities to build an education system that encompasses everybody, and they talked as friends with respect, realizing they might not have a perfect answer, but if they were a network, if they were genuinely respectful, they would come to the best available answer, and they would have more social solidarity than if they simply fought about it, if they just fought and never really discussed it. The idea of a Balkan network would have been inconceivable the day I took the oath of office as president over 18 years ago. We have President Constantinescu, the president of Romania. When I visited him, he was a very different leader than Mr. Ceausescu. And I was kidding him when I visited his office, and you now have the youngest prime minister in the world here. I remember when I was 34, I would let him be president of the United States if I could be 34 again. Unfortunately, I don't think I can make that deal. But all of the people who worked for him were under 30, practically. We were the oldest people in the entire office. But they believed that they could build a common future. He was exactly the opposite of someone who thought he had to order everybody around, put people who disagreed with him in jail, and brutalize people. And I see all these people that I served with. I respect them all enormously. But the point I'm trying to make is the idea of the network will take you to the best available answer. But it doesn't mean that government doesn't matter. It does. I've been to probably 110 countries just since I left office. There are no successful countries on earth that do not have both a strong private sector and a good government. And increasingly, groups like this, civil society, non-governmental organizations, some formal, some informal, who do two things. One, they just simply try to fill the gaps between what, at any given time, the public sector can provide and the private sector can produce. There are always such gaps in the social fabric. In the United States, these non-governmental organizations are older than the United States itself. Our very first one was established by our founding father, Benjamin Franklin, who was both a public philosopher and a scientist and a printer and a lot of other things. But he organized in the city of Philadelphia, our founding city, before our Constitution, a volunteer fire department. And if you think about similar situations in Macedonia or other countries today, it was a perfect case then for an NGO. Why? Because government was limited, the tax base was small, the government could not afford to set up a fire department. And no business person could set up a private business running a fire department, because if the building burned down, you couldn't pay the fire department. There was no private market to be made there. So Franklin just organized the volunteer operation. Today, there are places like that. So last year at our global initiative, where we gather people every year to do this work, you made a commitment to help provide health care to people who otherwise wouldn't have it, because the government couldn't reach it and it wasn't yet economic. There was no economic incentive for a business to try to do the same thing for the people who couldn't afford to pay for health care in the first place. So there will always be this. Now, in addition to that, the reason I think this network is important, because you have business people and political leaders, Non-governmental organizations are uniquely well-suited today to answer questions that are difficult, either by having the right process, I just described what's going on in Brazil, or having the freedom to experiment. Because if you organize an NGO, you know that it doesn't have to make a profit right away. It can try to find an answer, and then if it's a profitable answer, a business will take it up. And if you organize an NGO, and all of us, we're not running for anything, it's easier to fail. I mean, the Prime Minister is 34 years old. He's about to have his third child. And he's got to be a little careful. If he tries something new and it's a total failure, it's bad for politicians. But I'm not running for anything. I can fail every day. I say that to make you laugh, but think about it. If you need, in dealing with some of these complicated challenges, you need to have the freedom to fail. And I hope you will give his government the freedom to fail. You need to have the freedom to experiment, to say, well, I tried this, it didn't work, we're going to stop. But we're better off because we tried it, because now we know. Now we'll go on to something else. And I see this all over the world. In government and politics, most of the questions that are debated revolve around two things. What are you going to do? And how much does it cost? Whether it's spending or cutting taxes or whatever, right? There's very little debate in most places in the world on the third question, which I argue is maybe the most important question of the 21st century. Whatever you're going to do, and however much it costs, how do you propose to do it, so that your good intentions become real changes in people's lives? The how question is arguably the most important question of the 21st century. I just gave you two very difficult ones in Brazil. How can they have clean energy without destroying the rainforest and the Indian tribes? Good example. So, I believe that all of us have to take responsibility for that. So what has all that got to do with the Balkans? Here's my understanding of the current state of play. First, I think you should continue to seek to integrate the region with Europe and reach beyond your borders through the EU and NATO. And I believe you should continue to work on internal integration. I think that it's important to focus on one or two things. So let me make some more specific observations. The great barriers to building the Balkan region, the Europe that I dreamed of, that many of you have, and a world I would like to leave to my children and grandchildren, and yours too, when our time is up, are essentially two. One involves objective conditions. The other involves attitudes. The objective conditions are these. If you want to build a world of shared prosperity, and I find that when people are prosperous, it takes a lot of the other political problems away or makes them seem smaller. We can't have as much inequality in incomes and opportunities as exists today. Half the world's people live on less than $2 a day. 1 billion people live on less than $1 a day. 1 billion people have no access to clean water. 1 billion people go to bed hungry every night. That may make the inequalities within Montenegro, for example, seem small, but they exist here. You have to think about that. Because if you live in a market economy and you believe in it, In order for the people who are in business to do better and better and better and to hire more and more people and to allow more and more people to go to university, you have to keep expanding the circle of customers. And therefore, inequality, if it's too great, imposes enormous limits on economic potential. So the people were living on less than $2 a day. 85% of the people had no electricity in their homes. Half the children never went to school. And a cautionary, maybe, instruction for the trafficking issues in this part of the world. 200,000 children in a country of only 9 million were sold into a system of indentured servitude called Restavek, primarily not for sexual exploitation, primarily for forced labor, by parents who love them. But they would be told by the family who would give them sometimes as little as $40 or $50, I will give your child clothes on the back, food to eat, a place to sleep, and I will send them to school. They always know the last promise is a lie. They're almost never sent to school. They live in the back of the house in bad conditions. But what happens? If you have four children and no money, and you sell one, maybe you have enough money left to send the three to school that are left and feed them. It's a horrible dilemma and a function of inequality. A second objective circumstance we had to deal with is instability. You had this enormous run-up. You have one little example here in Montenegro. You had this enormous run-up in direct foreign investment, 3 years in a row of 9% economic growth. And then the global financial collapse happens, and it comes back to all the expansion and credit given by your banks. You didn't cause it. You didn't have anything to do with it. The rapid expansion in foreign direct investment was otherwise sustainable by your capacity to grow your own economy, but you got burned anyway. Now, what does this mean? Again, in a market economy, you must have some instability in any society. You want some room for change and different things happening. You want people to be stimulated to continue to improve, and there has to be some risk of failure to do that. But if there is too much instability, it does terrible things to the mindset of the people. After the United States was attacked by Al-Qaeda on September 11, 2001, I was asked by many people to comment about it because I had worked on this problem for a long time. And I told the truth. I said, look, I grieve for the people who were killed. Not just the Americans, but there were many people from other countries killed in the United States, including a substantial number of Muslims who were murdered on that day in our country. But it is very important that we respond to this crisis in a way that does not change the character of our country or compromise the future of our children by the way we react. And as you see from the last decade, it's been a continuous challenge both to be effective in the response and not to undermine the character of our country and the fundamental values we have. So that's the second challenge. Whether it's the financial crisis or the fight against terrorism, which you have contributed to by going to Afghanistan, for which I'm very grateful, or the spread of disease across national borders quickly, we have to find a way to have enough instability to permit the system to thrive in places like Montenegro and the other Balkan countries to rise, but not so much that people are paralyzed and they believe there is no longer any predictability to life, and you can no longer be sure you will be rewarded if you work hard and do the right things. And the final objective circumstance we face, I believe, is climate change, global warming. I'm very concerned about it. We are now having a huge flood in the Mississippi River in America. You probably have read about the massive flooding in America. But you may not remember that we had one right after I became president. It was a so-called 500-year flood, which means every house that was in the 100-year floodplain that is the areas that flood normally once every 100 years, they were all wiped out. And I had to move whole communities out of that 100-year floodplain. I thought we had done a good job. Now, only 17 years later, we just had another 500-year flood. And there's a lot of ice melt the further you go north on Earth. My wife just got back from Greenland meeting with the ministers from Russia and the Scandinavian countries in a group called the Arctic Council. And their meeting was fascinating. They essentially discussed three things. One, they all agreed on, that they would divide the Arctic, and it's 13 million square miles, in terms of which country would have primary responsibility in the event of a shipwreck or some other natural disaster. And then they had an amazing discussion about everyone's desire to use the warming of the North Pole and the melting of the polar ice cap to go after the oil and gas that's there. And at the same time, they were all saying, this is probably a bad thing. This shows the world is warming too fast. So why don't we burn some things and make it warm faster? I mean, it was a classic example. The plant life bloomed 15 days earlier above the Arctic Circle this year than it has, than was just a couple of years ago. And the North Pole is melting. You'll soon be able to take a ship across the North Pole. But if the ice cap on Greenland melts, it's 8% of all the world's fresh water. If it flows into the North Atlantic, it could block the Gulf Stream, which flows from south to north in the winter and keeps all of Scandinavia and part of Russia and part of Canada viable and workable in the wintertime, and the Baltic states. They could become as cold as they were 700 years ago, which means for 4 months a year they wouldn't have an economy. Think how it would change what they can do and how they can contribute to our common welfare, and how it could disrupt the entire rhythm of economic life in Europe. How could the EU enforce even its budgetary restrictions against its wealthy countries if they had no economy for 4 months a year? So we all have a stake in dealing with this. Now, I believe, based on my experience and the work I do all over the world today, that this is an enormous economic opportunity. I think when a society changes the way it produces and consumes energy to become both more efficient and to use more domestic sources and to put more fewer greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, it can lead to an explosion of economic growth. Germany, throughout this financial crisis, has maintained an employment rate 2% lower than the United States. Sweden has been lower. Denmark has been lower. Why? They are three of the four countries that met the climate change targets they promised to meet in 1997. And because of the way they changed and the way they produced and used energy, they generated so many new businesses, so many new jobs, so many growing economies, incomes, that it protected them against the worst of this financial crisis. But nonetheless, we have to face this. You can say, well, it won't affect Montenegro much if the sea level rises 4 feet because we're a mountainous country. But it would. Go look at the resorts again. Drive down the highway. It would. And yet, one country of 600,000 people can't possibly, it's like King Canute in the old Danish proverb trying to turn back the tides. This is something we have to do through networks together. And if the model for dealing with it is what the Brazilians are doing with the rainforest, because there are no perfect, easy answers. And no one has certainty about what exactly will happen when. But if we have networks and we have a shared vision that we want to minimize the inequality, we want to minimize the instability, we want to minimize the impact of destructive climate change, we'll get through this just fine. Now, before we get there, it is important to recognize that in addition to the objective barriers to building the kind of Europe, the kind of Balkans, the kind of world I hope will be built. There are the attitudinal problems. If you want to build a world of shared opportunity, you can't have too much inequality. If you want to build a world of shared responsibility, you can't have too much instability. But in order to get there, people have to have a sense of identity that allows them to be proud of who they are, to fight for what they think their people are entitled to, but to do it in the context of a world where what we have in common is more important than our differences. That, after all, is still the problem in Bosnia, isn't it? So the trick everywhere is, how do you give people a sense of ownership of their common destiny, of their differences, and still think about what we have in common? The truth is, the only way to win the future is to share it. That's why the networks are important. When I was a young man, I was always highly competitive, as you may have noticed. So I was interested in game theory. An election, for example, and a soccer match, a football match, are examples of zero-sum games. A zero-sum game is one in which, in order for someone to win, someone else has to lose. Which is why if a football match ends in a tie, you have the kickoff. And Americans are fanatic about their zero-sum games. In American basketball and American football, we keep playing until someone wins. A couple years ago, where I live on the East Coast, two of our greatest basketball teams had to play six overtimes till 1:30 in the morning to decide which one would win our championship. And as a result, they were both so tired that they were quickly eliminated in the national tournament 10 days later. But we got a winner. We like that. It's great for sports. The problem is, it doesn't work very well in real life. In real life, networking works. In real life, we have to find non-zero-sum games. In a non-zero-sum game, one party may do better than another, but no one has to lose. In fact, the winners will do even better if there are no losers. That is the network world. And you can't get that kind of world if people's mentality is zero sum. If people think more about past grievances than future possibilities. That's what I worry about with the agreement we made at Dayton and how it's playing out in Bosnia today. Because it permits people to stay in office and win elections by constantly reminding people of their grievances. And it permits people to stop others from realizing their aspirations. And that's what I pray that the Bosnians will get by. I just want to say a couple more things about this. This is a huge deal. Most of you are already there. The fact that you had a meeting with this title means that you understand this. But many people don't have the life experiences you do. So in order to imagine the future that you have already embraced, you have to help them get there. And a lot of this is very elemental. When I was president, I formed a very close personal friendship with Nelson Mandela. He's quite aged now, and he's frail, but his mind is still very sharp, and I try to go and see him once a year around his birthday. But one day we were talking about the day he was released from prison. Some of you may remember this. It was a Sunday morning in 1991. And he'd been in prison or house arrest for 27 years. So the day finally came, it was all arranged. And I don't know if you remember watching this on television, but I got my daughter up and took her downstairs. We sat in the kitchen and we turned on the television. I said, "Chelsea, this is one of the most important things you will ever see. Nelson Mandela is going free today." So we turned the television on, and by then he was already sort of shuffling because he'd been in a confined space for so long. But if you remember, he walked down a dirt road and he got in a car and they opened a gate that was locked and he drove out. It was a simple thing. So I said to Mandela, I said, "Look, we've been friends a long time now. I want to ask you an honest question. You are a great man, but you're also a very shrewd man. So it was a shrewd thing to ask your jailers to your inauguration. It was even shrewder to put the leaders of the parties who put you in jail in your government." He knew he needed them in South Africa. I said, "But now just tell me the truth. Chelsea and I watched you walk to freedom. When you were taking that last walk as a prisoner, didn't you hate them all over again?" And he looked at me. He was wonderful. He said, "Well, of course I did." He said, "In that last 100 yards I walked, I felt all the hatred again. After all, I've been abused physically and mentally. It ruined my marriage. I didn't get to see my children grow up. My country lost all those years of development. Yes, I was angry." He said, "To tell you the truth, I was also afraid. Because I hadn't been free in a long time. I didn't know if I could organize my life. But," he said, "right before I got in the car, I realized something. I realized that if I hated those people when I drove through that gate, I would still be their prisoner." He said, "I wanted to be free, and so I let it go. There are still too many people in this part of the world who have not made the decision to be free. Everybody's got something to resent. If you live long enough, somebody will do something terrible to you. And every day you spend resenting it is another day you let them take away from your life." Mandela got that. It's the one thing more than anything else that made him one of the great figures of our age. We have to do that. Let me make the point in one other way. In my last year as president, we had a network of countries supporting the profoundly important scientific research of sequencing the human genome so that we would understand the very basis of life. And we finished in 2000. And we had this great announcement. I was in the White House. Tony Blair was at 10 Downing Street. We had people from all over the world. I had all the ambassadors from all the countries that had contributed there in Asia and Latin America and Europe. And we were all involved. And we celebrated it. And then we began to learn things about our genetic makeup. From a political point of view, the most important thing we learned was this. Every difference you can see among all of us in this room, except age-related differences, every non-age-related difference you can see, the color of our skin, the color of our eyes, the shape of our bodies, even our race, the color of our skin, everything is the result of differences that are contained in between 0.5% and 0.1% of our genome. In other words, all of us are at least from a biological point of view, 99.5% identical, the same. And yet, all of us spend 99.5% of our time thinking about the other half a percent, don't we? We're not even about politics. I see you guys from Montenegro, I wish I were taller. I see the young people, I wish I were thinner. It's just human nature, isn't it? Here we are on this little planet, hurtling through our lives, spending all of our time thinking about what is different. And almost none of our time thinking about the fact that, after all, we're almost entirely the same biologically. Last year, there was another great discovery, late last year, saying that unless you are 100% descendant from sub-Saharan Africans, that is, you've not got anybody in your line back 100,000 years who's not a sub-Saharan African, if you have any other non-African blood in you, between 1 and 4% of your genome is inherited from our pre-human ancestors, the Neanderthals. Because outside of Africa for 40 years, Neanderthals and humans walked the earth together. They were bigger than we were, stronger than we were, had bigger brains than we did. They couldn't speak, but the reason they died out is probably because we could run and they couldn't. And we could run away from the giant mammals that then, and other animals that stalked the earth. Well, here's the thing. In America, at least, if you say someone's a Neanderthal, it's like saying they're backward and coarse and heavy-handed. So my wife and daughter were not at all surprised to learn that I am part Neanderthal. They were, however, stunned to learn that they were part Neanderthal. I say this, you say, what's that got to do with this? Everything. If you think about the past instead of the future, you're a prisoner. And if you think about only what's different from you, then you're so narrow you can't build the shared future. Look, what's different is important. What's different gave us Albert Einstein. What's different gave us Nelson Mandela. What's different gives us everything that's special and neat and wonderful. But it's not as important as what we have in common if we propose to share the future. We have to have a sense of our common humanity. That's what makes networking work. The intrinsic trust that the creativity and goodwill and forward thinking that all of us can bring to the table can make a difference. That's what I pray for the Balkans. You know, when I get on an elevator in New York City, and a young man or a woman looks at me working in this hotel trying to make a little money to go to school and says, I'm from Kosovo, I'm from Albania. I go to Cleveland and someone comes up and says, I'm from Serbia or I'm from Croatia. When someone comes up to me and says, it's in a classroom, says, I'm from Bosnia, thank you for stopping the killing in my country. My heart soars. And all I wish is that the way they feel about their lives would infect all the people back home where they come from. That's what I ask you to think about. Look, if we deal with the objective problems, if we care more about the future than the past, and if we're not arrogant, if we remember that our differences really matter a lot and they make life interesting, but what we have in common matters more, we're going to be just fine. And the future will be great. And Macedonia, because it is so breathtakingly beautiful, will grow rich. So don't mess it up. Good luck and God bless you.
Thank you.